Let me know if everyone can, or if anyone can see and hear everything properly. Hey, we've got Mikkel here in the chat. He seems excited about something. Indeed. Quadratically growing whoops coming from Mikkel. Can you hear me, Mikkel? Is everything all right? Am I still saying your name right, or did I lose it? Did I lose the pronunciation at some point? Okay, so here's my suggestion to you in the future. If you want to tell at least American English speakers how to pronounce your name, tell them to say the word nickel, because we have pennies and then nickels are 5 cents. A nickel, if you just say nickel with an M, I'm pretty sure that gets pretty close. That's how I think about it now. As of like a couple seconds ago, I realized that that's what I was basing it off of. Hey, Ginger Bill. All right, so I think we've got people here, and it looks like it's working. So I'm gonna go ahead and jump right in and get started. Yes, we need to open up the experimental file today. So I'm running right now what should be basically the releasable version of 4Coder. This is what will be going out the door in a day or two. What we're going to do today is just add some stuff to the power level here. I want to experiment with some possible things. And the first thing I want to do is going to be something I actually have a use for. Let me pull this up. So someone made the very good point that... it's not in here. It's in the lexer types. Yeah, that here I've listed out all the types of tokens, but when you see the type, it doesn't... Your debugger won't like translate that for you, right? There's a few reasons for that. Sometimes Visual Studio just refuses to translate this, even though it has all the information it needs to do the translation, just because it feels like being a dick. That can happen. It's also possible that I have not actually made enums here. What I actually have is an enum macro here, which doesn't actually define CPP token type as an enum. What it actually does is it defines CPP token type underscore as an enum, and then it lets me type def that to some integer type, because I am not the kind of person who uses enums as, you know, a type separate from the integer. Instead, I want it to be exactly equivalent to an integer type, because that's how I tend to think about what they actually are. So I don't really like the idea of overloading. I guess you could do some clever stuff if you overloaded on your enums, but I feel like there should be a different language construct for that. It should be like some kind of strong enum or strong type def or something like that. Like, you could just make types like... Yeah, I don't know. Or you just not overload it and give the function a different name. How's that for language construct? Yeah, Mikkel is suggesting a thing where, like, if my cursor is right here, it will show at the top what function I'm in. And that kind of stuff is a someday kind of thing. I don't want to do that until I have better code intelligence, because the real plan to do is to just... is to basically kind of display the code as like block statements, and things like this, and then which block you're in, or like which function you're in, will be kind of a part of the display. I could put it up at the top there, but that would just come out of the code intelligence then. Whereas if I did it right now, it'd be a hack, and it wouldn't even handle things like macros like this one, which I kind of want to find a way to handle. So, yeah. Bad Fly Dog asks if a user can add custom keywords to the new Lexer. Not to the one the Lexer is not a li is like a library I released, and you do have access to that, so you can use it to Lex your own stuff. It doesn't quite let you. It doesn't have an the API doesn't quite let you add in custom keywords for the forcoder Lexer, because forcoder doesn't. The API lets you read out tokens from a file, but it doesn't let you. It doesn't put you in control of lexing the file, because I actually do a lot of stuff to run that in parallel and to like try to do as little bit of a small amount of relexing as possible during each edit, so that the relevant section of tokens doesn't have to be relexed all the time, right? And I want to stay in control of that on the forcoder side, because it is something that's some that I think should be standardized and just handled for the user, because basically all code needs to be lexed. But I do agree, what I should have is an extension to the API that lets you say, here are, like, I'm establishing my lexing context, I want these keywords to be appended to the standard keywords. That'll come in the next version or two of the Lexer. But for now, you would just have to, you wouldn't get it in forcoder, but any user of the Lexing library could just expand the keyword set. This drunk Dane, it's just not that easy to determine when I'm looking at a function definition just from the tokens, especially not in like C style. If I was, if this was Odin or something, where the declaration of a function is very easy to tell from, you know, the syntax, it might be possible, but I'm gonna put it off. Okay, so anyway, the first thing I want to do is to make this easier for users, is to put like the equals zero here, equals one, and so on and so on. But I don't want to write that all by hand, and if I ever change the order of these, I want a way where I can just say, all right, put my cursor like right here and write out the standard enum values in order. So that's what we're gonna do is first is a thing that just sort of if you do like that to skip to it and then write out the enum values, assuming that the enum values you want go from 0 to n. That way I can maintain that enum very easily while putting the numbers in it, so that you can see which number goes to which enum very easily as well. Let's see, mark matching brace, cursor surroundings. Let's put it right here. Okay, so we're going to call this explicit enum values write explicit enum values. Yeah. Okay, so what this needs to do is first, actually, yeah, if I'm starting on a brace, let's get the tokens out. Gingerbil, yeah, I'm gonna do that eventually. I'm gonna write a preprocessor and eventually a parser on top of the current Lexer. But the way I want to do it is I want to make it allow, like, I don't want to just output the text and then like link up the new text to the actual text. And I mean, that's what you could do, right? Is you could just run the preprocessor and output, here's what the preprocessed version of this code looks like. And then you have ways of linking up this position in the preprocessed code, links up with this position in the actual code. And then from there, it's not too hard to extract the the meaning of things, especially if you do that also like and then parse it. But yeah, I think that the better thing to do is to have something that doesn't output a second text file, but rather just creates the data structure that represents. Basically, what I want to do is make intermediate data structures from which you could print text at any point. So like with Elixir, the Elixir gives you tokens, and you can use those tokens to print the file back out if you want, but the tokens themselves don't recontain the text. Again, Clang and LLVM, they just, you have to run them and then get the result. I can't do things like store an intermediate data structure and try and do the minimal amount of work to like to keep those up to date, as far as I can tell. I mean, I also don't want to deal with like trying to compile Clang on Windows, because it just eventually would drive me crazy too to maintain that, and I think I would have more fun trying to write it myself. One second, where is, ah, there's the issue. So, plus then it can't use the already lexed tokens that I have. But I'm gonna get to the preprocessor soon, since the lexer is being wrapped up. I've integrated the lexer. I gotta optimize a few things still. There's still some things I can do faster. But I'm getting pretty happy with the lexer. Anyway, what I want to do is I want to switch to, yes, where do I get the token array? Somewhere around here. Get all tokens. So, I only want to access open files and views for this one because I'm going to do an edit operation, which means I shouldn't really be accessing read-only stuff. Okay. So get all those tokens, and then what I want to do is say, let's see, do I have the, oh, that's in the lexer, right? So get lexer.h. Let's pull you up over here. Get token. CPP get token. I give that the array and the position I will get from the view cursor position. And that goes into the token result. So I should not be in white space. And I should just double check that the index I get, where is this struct here? Okay, that's weird. Result. That must be in token types. Lexer types. There we go. Result. So token index is less than or equal to, no, less than the array count. Make sure that I can actually, you know. And that reminds me, I should be wrapping this in a temp, since I don't want to allocate that array forever. So that gets me the tokens. Token index is less than the count. Then I get a token, which is, I get the tokens out of the array, and I get the token index into that array. There we go. Okay, so I have a token, and I want to make sure that that token type equals brace token brace open. Okay, so now I've got that. If I'm on a brace open, then I'm at the beginning of the enum I want to redo. What I could do is in the future say that it, you know, if I had a smarter system, it would ask just the code intelligence, am I inside of an enum right now, rather than this, and then it would work anywhere. But I want to limit it to this so that you can't, like, accidentally hit it in odd locations that cause, like, bad behavior. This way it only works when you very explicitly are trying to make it happen. Okay. So, we are on a brace open. Now, the assumption should be that the enum code here could be arbitrarily complex in terms of there could be comments that we need to ignore of various kinds. There could already be existing things written there. And there could even be comments in unfortunate locations, like so. So the question becomes, what do I want to do with those unfortunate comments? I think I want to take that comment and pop it out there, maybe? I mean, an even more unfortunate location would be right here, because now I have to... Okay, so basically the rule is going to be actually not that bad. It could be bad if I did like that, right? Or if I have some nasty macro that's like blah, that doesn't do anything there technically. So, I will... I'll just say if you wrote unfortunately located comments, it's too bad, but your code shouldn't be so neurotic, and we'll just lose those. Okay. So the rule will be find an identifier. So I'm gonna need like this to be a token pointer, and I'm also gonna want a token end, which is right here, the one past the end token. And then I'll do something like while token putter, never write while, I always end up regretting it. Okay, while token putter is less than token end, plus plus the token putter. And then if the token putter's type is an identifier, then we'll assume that that is an enum word and not like a preprocessor. So again, your enums just have to be sort of a list of identifiers with no macros in there and with no comments between here and the comma. Right? Then what I want to do is say, all right, if that's the case, then actually what we're going to actually want here is like switch on the token putter type. In the case that I find CPP token identifier, there is something I'll want to do there. But in the case, PD Codes asks if I had any trouble getting an OBS to C4 coders window, and the answer is, the way I ended up doing that is, that I'm actually on full screen, so let me demonstrate. Oh, here's how I'll demonstrate. Right? So yeah. And then to make that work, I had to put it in single, I had to put it in what I call stream mode, which doesn't double buffer. If it double buffers, then it messes stuff up sometimes, which might include when you put it in that mode. I just added stream mode in the newest version, so in the past I've never used full screen because it had issues like that, but once I realized that I could just switch to single buffering to get it to fix, it all was good. Okay, so anyway. CPP token identifier, CPP brace close, token brace close. There we go. PD Codes, no, I don't use SDL, but it is just straight OpenGL, which is often similar to SDL in terms of how it actually puts to the screen, because SDL usually, I think it has an OpenGL mode that most people use, which means that if it's double buffered, it would have the same effect. Okay, so if I get a brace closed, and then we're done. Okay, and so I'm gonna have like a go to finished, and then we'll put finished right there. And I'm gonna have a little like closed correctly equals 0. Closed correctly equals 1, right? So if I get to a brace close, I close the enum correctly. Now, if I see an identifier, then what we're going to do is we're going to create an edit range. The edit start is going to be the token putter start plus the token putter size, so everything after this token. The edit stop is going to be the edit start for now, but we're going to loop forward and see if we can't find a reason to move the edit start forward. So then we'll do for token putter still less than token end plus plus token putter, and that will also want to start with a plus plus token putter because we've already read this token, we already know what it is. Don't care. All right, so here what I want to do is say if token putter switch, I meant to say token putter type case CPP token comma, or if I happen to find the brace close, because the final member of the enum I often don't close with a comma. I just let the brace close that one. Either one works, I think. Actually, maybe it doesn't. I know it works for lists. If you're listing integers, you can put an integer and a comma and then nothing. That's fine, but I'm not sure if it works on enums. But anyway, but we'll say that it's optional. But if it does see the brace, then it needs to close. So that needs to be a little bit of a different case. Okay. So if it sees a comma, then edit stop equals token putter start, and then I go to good edit. If it's brace closed, then I do same thing, but I also want to set closed correctly to a 1. That way I know, this is also closed and it was closed correctly, so we can perform the edit later. Okay, so I've now specified the range from the end of the identifier to the beginning of the comma, and that's the place we're going to be replacing with the new thing. Now, the new thing is just a string that says space equals space and then an integer, right? And yeah. So to do that, what we need is int 32 value equals 0, and I need like char star string base equals let's take first of all let's take out that as a variable in case I ever want to pull this out into a separate function. Okay. And then down here, what we'll do is we'll say, look, this equals, I forget the rule here. What is the name of it? Partition remaining on the part. Oh wait, no. String base equals partition current on that, and then I'm gonna make a string called string base 0, and then the size will be however much memory is left in the partition. So I'm going to use just try to use the whole thing. And then what we'll do is we'll say at each step what I'm doing is I'm appending to the string this, and then I'm appending an int to the string, in particular the value, and then I'm incrementing the value. Right, and then all I have to do is before all that starts, I need to take int 32 string position equals the string size at the time before I did any appending, and then the string size will come down here. String size will be the new size after appending that minus the string position. So now I have the position in the whole string of where the edit starts, or where the source text starts, and how long it is. And that is all I need to make an edit. Now, the trick is I want to do this as a batch edit. So let me pull up real quick. API docs. There we go. Types and functions. Batch edit. So it needs the string, the string length, blah 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 blah. I haven't written the description for this yet because I'm an ass. Okay. Yeah, I need some edits, or I need an edits array, which I haven't set aside room for. I took all of the memory for the string that I'm outputting. So now I need to decide how I want to estimate how many edits there will be, or if I'm going to count them first. I could count all the values in the enum. It would require me looping over it twice. I could estimate it by counting the number of tokens between the open and closed brace. It'd be a cheaper loop than trying to count the exact value, because I don't have to check the type against multiple values and then have an incrementer. I just find the n token and then take the difference, and then divide by 2 plus 1 would give me enough room. And I might overestimate that way, but not by very much. By probably no more than 50% in the worst case. Yeah, and the chance that we run out of memory on this operation is pretty small, because most enums, like my CPP token type enum, is pretty much the longest enum that I've ever written. And I don't remember seeing enums much longer. I think like maybe a key codes enum might be longer. But still, we have like a megabyte or two on that array. I don't think we're going to run out. Okay, so I think the right way to do this is, before we do that, I'm going to set, I'm going to do a quick loop. Token putter, excuse me, token seeker equals token putter. While the seeker is less than token end, this also means we can avoid a lot of work, because we'll find out whether it's closed properly much earlier. Okay, so the token seeker is going to switch on its type. If it sees a token token putter, seems better actually. If I see a token brace close, then go to finished seek, which will happen right here. If I see a CPP token brace open, I'll add a little extra, like closed correctly equals one, right? And then we'll only continue if this whole thing was closed correctly. And then once we're in there, what we want to do is get an estimate for how many tokens there probably are, so, or how many values there are. So value count estimate or count estimate equals the token seeker minus the token putter, and then I want to divide that by 2 and do 1 plus that amount. Right, because if you had 3 tokens, that could be an identifier, a common identifier, so you need 2 spaces. Actually, that reminds me, if I do that, I don't want to do that. Go. So yeah, I'm gonna get my guess I should set closed correctly to 0 again. So I get my count estimate there, and then I want to get let's pull up the docs again. I want a buffer edit array. That can store at least that many, and I'm gonna put an edit count right there. Now, what we do is at each step, we get this far, we say, all right, if this is a, if the edit is good, right, then we'll continue forward, and else we'll just go to finished. If we get a bad one, then something went wrong, and ignore this. Can't really recover from that. It's not a good idea to edit the buffer in these complex ways if I don't think everything worked out right. Okay, so if the edit is good, we have yeah, now we can just take the edits we put right there, and I just put down the edit. So I just need to take now a moment to create the buffer edit from all of this existing information. And a buffer edit, I go back. That should be documented around here somewhere. Wait a minute. You're telling me this doesn't have a... Ah, there we go. See also. Perfect. String start, length, start, end. Got it. Perfect. So, string start is what I called string position. Len is string size. Start is the start position of this edit up there. End equals edit stop. And then I put that into the edit count, and then I want to assert that the, I think I have lowercase asserts here, I'm not sure, I'm never sure when I'm writing custom code, which things I use, which things I don't use. So, I want to assert that that is still less than the count estimate. I don't believe it should be able to get greater than the count estimate. Because it has to read an identifier and then skip one forward and then find a comma, which means it has to read two tokens every time it does this at minimum. It could actually be as much as four times, or twice as too big if each of them already has a value written. But again, I'm not really worried that I'm overestimating and losing too much memory. Okay. Although what I should do is, I'll handle that stuff later. I'll handle that stuff when it comes up. Okay, so I add that to the edits, and then I go to the next edit. Right, so I output the new edit onto the edit array. The string stays there. I don't actually write the string unless I know everything is going to go through anyway. That seems good. So now when we're finished, if I closed correctly, then I've made sure that everywhere I say that to true, that indicates that I should go ahead and do the edit. So now, I just call up buffer batch edit, which... Bullshit. There we go. Alt backspace didn't work. Which looks like this. So I need the app pointer, which I have. I need a buffer pointer, which I can get. String comes from string base. The string length is the string size. Here's the edits array. Here's the edit count. And I need to decide a type. This will be... What kind of types do I have? Batch edit normal. Buffer string base edit count, blah blah blah. So let's see. That only happens if we actually got a token successfully for the current position. What about the next one up? So I have to be on a brace open. That's good. Closed correctly. So the next one down says if the initial seek didn't close correctly, then just skip everything. And then this one here is if that closed correctly happens again. Which in theory it might not. I'm not sure if it would have to not hit the brace again, even though it hit a brace the first time. it should always hit, but I'm gonna leave it the way it is for now. Right, so, let's see. I think it's done. So let me just rebuild it. Not writing code in C, gotta cast that. Ah, buffer batch edit. Good edit. Ah, so I need the good edit right here. Okay. Let's run a little test. Oh, I haven't bound this to any keys yet. Let me do that real quick. All right, so if I'm in a code file, I want to bind something with some modifier to write explicit enum values. Okay, now what should I do? What should I do? I don't want it to be too close to this key here because I don't want to accidentally be able to go to a bracket or go to a brace and trigger this without meaning to. Alt Shift E is for exit, so I don't want it to be too close to enum. V, Alt V is unused. Alt C, Alt B, yeah, none of the surrounding things are important. So I could do V for value. Up and down are used. Control page up is used. I can do Alt page down. Alt insert. Control insert. Modifier. Control. Bindings modifier C3. Okay, and the key codes key insert. All right, let's try this now. If I go to enum, I'm gonna skip to that and then control insert. Uh-oh. Edit count is 4. How did you get up to 4? What is the token putter pointing at right now? Don't know, it's a 44. Okay, great. So well, somehow it did get the wrong token estimate. 4 should have been enough. So 4 is a good estimate, which means it isn't the estimate that was wrong. It somehow didn't. It somehow didn't output the right number of tokens. So, or the right number of writes. So edit count is 0. If I see an identifier, I begin looping forward until I find the comma or the brace close. So I should eventually find the comma right away, actually, and that becomes that. Edit is going to go to good edit. So if the edit is good, then I would write it out. And then in that case breaks, we come to here. That's the end of the switch. We come to here. It's the end of the for loop. And then we'd go to the next. Oh, I see. So this loop here is always going to the next pointer, but this code here has gone to the comma and stopped. Well, no. It stopped at the comma, which means when it goes to next, the next thing it should see is the next identifier, which shouldn't be an issue. But somehow it blew past the second brace here, this close brace. I step forward one there, which means I should see the comma right away and go to good edit. I leave my point, my token pointer on the comma from then on. So when it gets to here, it should go plus plus and land on the next identifier right away, which means it comes here. And it does that again. It goes to the next one, it reads the next type, which should be a comma. So it goes to good edit. Outputs that, so that's 2. The token is still on the comma, so it comes around here, goes to the next identifier. This time it switches on this type and it sees an identifier, but then actually it sees a comment, so it goes again. Now it sees an identifier, but it hasn't output anything. And now it sees the identifier, it goes to the next one, which is the close brace, so it sees that right away. Closed correctly is 1. Edit is good is 1. Goes here. It outputs the third token. And oh, then it goes to the next pointer and keeps looping. Why didn't it end? Because normally the way I end is by going to finished here. So I need a clause here that says, if edit is not good or if I closed correctly, I want to go to finish. Line 400. All right, let's try this now. I go here, and then I insert those. Hey, cool. Now suppose I said that that's a 10, and then I insert. It should write that back into a 1. Ah, it did, but it didn't handle this, which is problematic. The reason it didn't do that is because even though the equals 2 was valid, code that it should have been replacing. I told it not to replace anything between there and the brace because I don't want to delete the new line. So I guess what I need to do is just always explicitly put the new line in myself and do delete everything in that range. And undo works just fine, so that's good. All right, so, yeah, that's fine. I just have to tell it to edit all the way to this point, and then, and then if closed correctly, then I want to append a new line after everything else. So now I should be able to insert, change that to a 10, insert again, and it just fixes it. I should be able to rearrange these. And insert, and there we go. Cool. Right. So the undo works well, so it looks like this works. It might be a bit bugged, but at least we know that insert or the undo works, so I'm not too worried about making a change and then having to go like restore the git or something, because at least undo can save me if everything else is broken. So let me take that out of my test file. Then we'll come over here to the Lexer types, and then right here, let's try it. Whoops, not that. Take me there, and then insert. Cool. Okay. So that's neat, for sure. Are there any other enums that deserve full detail here? These are all internal enums, they don't matter. This one I might as well. There we go. Okay, let's see if there's anything else I want to do that way in the other types header. Enum. So let's see. That's totally bugged. Gotta get the batch edit fixed actually, so maybe we should do that next. Okay, I'm happy with that. So, one thing done today. All right, so that's 1 hour in. There's a couple things. I could try to fix the bug with batch edit, which seems like a good idea since I've been using the multi-line editing and I've wasted a little bit of time when that's caused bugs. And it's also just caused a bug just now, and if I'm gonna use that enum editor thing, that enum maintaining thing, I might want to have it working better there. So, could go fix that. The other thing I want to do is, right now, the thing that skips to open and close braces doesn't use tokens. So if you have like braces that are in comments or strings, which I do in a few places in my meta generator, it messes everything up. So I would like to fix that. But I think getting that's I don't know, that's more minor. I think it'll be more interesting to get the bug that we just saw fixed. So to do that, we first have to go read the code that's responsible. And before we do that, I think I'd like to take a short break. I'll be back in like 5 minutes. Alright, hello, back. Not quite 5 minutes. Was Miblo able to see the stream? I don't know. It sounded like he was dealing with something at some point. All right, so All right, so let's take a look, see if I can find where that bug is. That's somewhere in file view. Batch edit. Token fixing. So if it's a normal token fix, I do that. If it's a white space token fix, I do that. All right, so what I'm doing is I'm saying I equals 0 to batch size plus plus I start equals edit start end. I thought I was doing these in reverse order. Did I not do these in reverse order? Seriously? That looks like I'm taking the first edit in the batch, getting it start and end, and shift amount, and then applying the relex to that. Oh my goodness. Okay, so what this is supposed to say is batch size minus one. I must have been. This was the plan I came up with. Well, I should go back and rewatch the stream where I did this. Did I just like come up with a plan and then write totally erroneous, stupid code that didn't at all achieve my plan? This is what it's supposed to look like. All right, let's try this. Control insert. Now that did mess up a bunch of stuff. That fixed it. If I do this. No, everything's broken now. Okay, so something. There's something about this that I'm not understanding, I guess. Because it seems like this is what should work. History before edit. Yeah. Right there, I get the batch. And that came from the spec step, which up here put this batch onto the undo children array. Which means. Oh, that's totally not gonna work because when I go backwards, even though if it lined up it would work, the problem is. Yeah. Okay, so there's something more clever I could do. But we're gonna stop trying to do that stuff right now. We're gonna make it work correctly. Because most batch edits in practice aren't spread across the file, they're in the same area. Which means I should be able to do this. So I'll just do the relax from the beginning of the first edit to the end of the last edit and give it the shift amount of the entire batch. Which I believe I have somewhere. Yeah, it's gotta be in multiple locations here. I just need to pull it out of one of these. So I fix the file metadata. Here I'm doing cursor fixing. Let me pop over to file here. File edit cursor. That must be in file view then. File edit cursor fix. Yeah. Okay, so it's in under buffer, probably abstract, buffer, batch. Okay, how about shared? Buffer, batch, edit, update cursors. So I give it the sorted positions and the sorted edits, and Let's see. Shift amount. Yeah, at the end here I have a shift amount. And I'm not returning anything yet, so out it comes. And then what I can do is right here, int 32 shift out, right? And then I just set if shift out int 32 shift total equals blah blah, if shift out shift out equals shift total. I'll put this down here 2, even though it's actually being passed in the description, so the user already knows it. Hopefully I'll just pass zeros in those cases anyway. See if that works. Control insert. All right. Oh, that's wild. That's it right there. All right, cool. So that works. And all the undoing works. Okay. And there we go. So there we go. Yeah, so let's do, unless anyone else has any suggestions for their code manipulation. I'd love to come up with code manipulation other than what I'm about to do, which is just navigating to the nearest, you know, parent brace. If you have any other ideas, like the enum one, like code manipulation things like that, throw them out there and I'll consider them. I will consider their value. I'll give a minute for you to think up some ideas and share them. For instance, what we could do is the ability to manipulate an entire block of code at once, like, you know, comment out existing block, like the block that I'm currently in. Mikkel suggests parameter renaming. Which in theory isn't actually impossible. I don't think. You'd have to specify the name to change the other name. We wouldn't be able to handle sub-declared variables of the same name. They would just get renamed too. We could make it automatically, like, detect the name of the parameter you have your cursor on and then change it by reading out the name from the token and then using the opening and closing, the first opening brace and its matching close brace to create a range and then just do a replace in range on the new name of the word. Like I said, we could end up in that situation changing names other than the ones we wanted. So what we could also do is token by token look for identifiers whose lexemes are exactly equal to the parameter name. We could still be changing names of things that we don't mean to change, but it'd be rare. It would be in cases where you had another name that would have the same meaning or had a different meaning in the same scope, which only ever happens when you subscope and like shadow that name within the same function. I don't think you could have like a global with the same name because you couldn't refer to it in that function then. It wouldn't be able to do all sorts of code intelligence stuff that I would want it to do, like someday double checking that it's not going to shadow any global variable names that you're actually going to use and stuff like that. But I think we could do something like that. I think we can do that, Mikkel. Ginger Bill suggests moving declarations, as in a thing that moves all your declarations to the top of your scope for you. I'm not sure if I can handle that yet. All right, I'm gonna go with Mikkel's idea because with code de with variable declarations, the problem that I don't necessarily know how to handle about moving them to the top of the scope is it's a bit of a parsing issue still. I don't know if I can tell the difference between a variable declaration and other things necessarily. Yeah, because I don't have any kind of abstract syntax tree, so I'd have to tell straight from the tokens, am I looking at a declaration? And I don't know how I would tell if something I'm looking at is a declaration or, like, for instance, just a multiplication or a function call in some cases. Yeah, I'm not sure. I think that in C, the context is difficult enough that I want to wait until I have a code intelligence engine put backing me up to do that. But I can try out this other one. Okay, so for experiments. So, let's go back down to write explicit enum values after that one. Let me leave a little note here. Some basic code manipulation ideas. Custom command sig rename parameter. All right. So same idea. Ba-ba. This will also expect you to be on the token you're talking about, and it needs to be a real token, so that's a good check there. Alright, so far so good. I need to end the temp memory here. And now, I can get the token pointer for... Yeah, the token I'm on now. Right, and that should be an identifier. Then we can continue, and I'll store that as, well, what I want is like, old Lexeme. I'll just say, look, let's try to keep, let's try to keep this inside of 128 characters. I don't think many parameter names get longer than that. There we go. So we got a nice empty string ready to go. And then what I want to do is size equals the token putter's size, and then I want to read a range out of the buffer. I'm going to need the docs for this. So, can we go back to the top? Alright, read range. That's read tokens. Read range. So I need the buffer, start, and the out position. Alright. So there's my buffer. The start would be the token putter start. The end would be token putter start plus token putter size, and the out position would be old lexeme.stir, right? So that will read in there the lexeme for the original identifier. Then what we'll do is we'll say for go to the next token putter. Token putter is less than token end. Go to the next token putter again if we still haven't gotten what we're looking for. Better come up here and specify what the token end is. The token end is that plus the number of tokens minus 1 to account for that zero-based indexing. And looking now for the open brace. If token putter type equals token brace open, and let me make that a switch. I really need to write the thing that converts a partially written if to a switch, because I do this to myself every single time. And there we go. Because I also want to handle the case where I might see a brace close first, but then it's not a parameter, and I want to prevent it from going on to the next function and renaming stuff there, right? If I can help it. I also want to stop if I see a paren open. Can we get open the lexer types here so that I can get some word completion on them? Alright, so then all of these need to be able to break out, so I'll go here and say that it's like double break, I guess. Go to double break. Here I want to say found procedure proc body found equals 1, proc body found equals 0. Okay, now, the next goal here is that I find each identifier and each time I find an identifier, I read out its lexeme if the size is correct and see if I should replace it. Okay, so that becomes token putter. No, don't plus plus that token putter, because we just found the brace open. So yeah, plus plus the token putter, but only continue if the proc body was found. Yes. And while the token putter is still less than token end, I'd like to continue, and I'd like to keep on incrementing all the way through. And there we go. Now, if switch on the token putter type, there you go, Alan, catching yourself before we write stupid shit, find the identifier, or find the brace close, at which point I want to go to double break 2, there. Okay, so now if I find an identifier, what I want to do is say, look, I have a question. Is the size of this token equal to the size of the old lexeme? If so, we have a real possibility that there needs to be a replacement happening here. So then we need to do char other lexeme base. Let's take 128 as a limit again. And what we'll do is, by the way, just for double safety here, we're going to say if token putter size is less than the size of old lexeme base. That way we can't get a crash out of that built-in limitation. And then we can't read this anymore, so we just bump that down like that, and we bump that down like that. Or we bump that over there and that like that. No, I still gotta do that. Yeah. Okay, so anyway. Okay, so now we want to do something similar to this. We know that here's the other lexeme base. Here is the other lexeme, which is going to be make fixed width string other lexeme base, and then I need to tell it that its size equals the old lexeme size, and then I need to read out of the buffer the exact same thing I did here, like that, but instead of other old lexeme, I read out of into the other lexeme, and then if there's a match between the old lexeme and the other lexeme, then we do a replacement. And to do that replacement, I will do the same thing I did down here. Oh, shoot. If I'm going to do this, if I replace the text with other text, if I replace it right now, then it's not going to be grouped into one big edit, so you can't undo it all at once. You have to do it, undo it one at a time. But it also has the nasty consequence that if the tokens get incorrect, then this whole thing goes out the window, so you actually can't replace it yet, because then it fucks up all the tokens, they're all in the wrong spots and everything. So you really do need to cache up the whole batch at once if you're going to rely on the tokens and then fire it at the end, which means we're back to the original problem from the other one. I need to know how many edits in the batch there are going to be, and this time I don't know how to estimate it. I might just need to count it. And I don't want to write all this code twice, because that would be a pain. So, what we're going to do is say, alright, counting lexemes equals true, int 32 lexeme, counting matches is what I'll call it, match count equals 0 equals 1, actually, because the original lexeme, I kind of want to store CPP token original token equals token putter, by the way, just a thing for later. That'll come back in an important way near the end. Okay, so the match count starts at 1, and I'm counting matches. So if I find a match, if I'm counting matches, then the match count gets incremented. Else we'll do other work, right? And then what we'll do is say, for match count equals matches, counting matches is greater than or equal to 0, minus minus counting matches. That's some absurd code right there. Boom. Okay, so the idea is now I need to know token start putter equals token putter. And then down here, I set token putter to the token start putter. This way, the second time through, the token putter starts at the right place again. And then it immediately adds 1. So why don't we just add that 1 there and take that out? Okay. And then token putter is less than end. Since we're doing it this way, when we get to the end here, what we want to do is, okay, so first thing we need to do is edit batch, buffer edit, edits equals 0, we're counting up how many we need in the, how many matches we have, and the string base equals 0 for now, and the string is null, right? And then what'll happen is the first time through we are counting matches. So in that situation we'll do one thing, and in this situation we'll do a different thing, right? And so to do that later. And now if I'm counting matches, what I do once I've counted them is that the edits, I push an array onto the partition of buffer edits. I need the match count of them. And then the string base becomes partition current. And string becomes make string on the string base from 0 to partition remaining. Oh man. So here's a question. Why did Intobot just tell me what Miblo was tweeting? Is that like a standard? Does he always do that, Intobot? Does he just report on Miblo's tweets? Or what's the deal? Anyway, so here I've set up the string, And the edits and the string base, match count. And what I still want is in 32, edit count equals 0. Okay, we'll set that to 0, and then what we'll do is down here we'll make a buffer edit for param string, or param, yeah, param string edit or something like that, right? And then edit count will equal the param string edit, all right? And then edit count plus plus. And we'll figure out how to do that in a moment. That is filling out param string edit. Okay. Now, right here, we have the information we need to do the rest of this. So, we make a buffer edit here, call it the edit. Now, the edit ranges from the token putter start to the token putter start plus the size. It has a string start, I believe, at the string size, and it has an edit len of this minus the string size. And then just all I have to do is in between there, I have to. Oh, do you guys want to know a magic trick? This is gonna be cool as fuck. So, yeah, this is totally different. String start is going to be 0, and the size is just going to be the replace string size. And that means I already know how to fill out two of these because they're the same too. And yeah, okay. So basically, when we got this far, I have to stop and do something else for a moment, and that is I have to come over here to the include CVP, and I have to get replacing range, and I need this. Replace string will be. By the way, why do I do it this way? How about I just do this way over here? And that will reduce my line count by two. Okay. So that is the with string. And yes, totally awesome. So now, replace string dot size is, yeah, perfect. So I tell it where to run that. String base equals partition current. Yeah, fuck all that. Don't need to do any of it. So I just push that array on there. And that means I haven't finished with the magic trick yet, Mikkel. I'm still explaining the magic trick. So the magic trick is this. I just got rid of the thing that has to allocate the string. And if I don't need to allocate the string, it means I could just allocate the whole partition to the batch edit array, the array, the buffer edits, which means I might not need to do the counting. Basically, the magic trick, by the way, was that I was going to basically all of the multiple replacements are all going to be driven from one the same place. They're replacing different ranges, but I'm replacing them with the same text over and over again, so I don't need to have it copied 100 million times, or five or however many times the replacement happens, which is what I would have done. And it's like if you looked at the other one that I wrote space equals space and then a number, and then space equals space and then another number. I wrote all of that into the string because each replacement was replacing with a different string. Not true here. They can all the replacements can be driven by one small string that I can store on the stack, which means I don't need to allocate any space for it, which means that the right way to do this is totally different. This is all just all of that is gone. And counting matches doesn't need to happen anymore, so thank goodness that nonsense is gone. Match count can just go fuck itself. So we don't need any of this or any of that. What we do need is those guys to go away, and I need to set this equal to the buffer edit partition current. And then I need a max. I need to know what my max is. Edit max equals. And that is just going to be, whatever you get when you take partition remaining, right, and divide that by the size of buffer edit. Right? So there's my edit max. And all I have to do is right here, just assert that my edit count is less than my edit max. And then I can take my edits and edit count equals the edit plus plus edit count. And in fact, I could do one better, which is just to say, let's not even crash in this case. Let's just, if it works, do that. Else, go to double break. All right, so yes, that means we can also handle this the easy way because I don't need to think about how to do this later since everything else is done already. So edit count equals, and this means we need edit max if edit max greater than or equal to 1, do this. Otherwise, do ignore it, and the thing will fail later anyway. So if edit count, if we can set that, I just need to set it to an edit, and then increment it, and then edit dot. We know how to set most of this up, but I'm just going to copy all of that, and then the only difference is instead of token putter arrow, what we actually want is original token dot. Is that right? So that puts in the replace for the actual parameter that we're replacing, and then all of the subsequent ones just get replaced for free in the body of the function. And by for free, I mean after doing this loop here. So the old lex theme still works. Yes. If we read that range and if it matches old one there that we're replacing, then we store up another batch edit there. And the only thing I want to be able to do is say, let's encode in some way a useful sort of just measure of whether or not it ended correctly. So finished correctly, closed correctly was the word I was using before, and we'll close correctly if and only if we see a brace close. Otherwise, we got to the end of a file and this wasn't really a function, or we got to, we ran out of memory, something like this. Okay, so If it closes correctly, then we just do the batch edit. Alright, so to do the batch edit this time, the string base is just going to be replace string.stir, replace stir.size, replace string.size, edit, edit count, and batch edit normal. That should be an array.count, not a tokens.count. Got a little bit, oh, it should be a count, not a counts. Alright, got a little ahead of myself writing that code there. Then I just grab that, go down to the insert, and let's call this context something, something, something. Okay. So, what should the key be for this? It renames a parameter. Control A and Control Q both rename things, either Q with a query or A in a range. Control 1 is taken. Control W is taken. Control S is taken. Z is taken. X is taken. Control P is taken, Control R is taken, Control E is taken, Control D is taken, Control F is taken. All of these are taken. G is taken. Control T. Technically, that's free, and Control B is free. N is taken, right? Yeah. M is taken. H. Oh. Yeah, that's the history one. Don't actually want to hit that because it's broken. Okay. Control Y is taken. J, that's lowercase, uppercase. Yeah, so it can't be a control key unless I do a number or F key. Alt P is free. I believe. Yeah. Let's do Alt P. Mikkel, I don't have like Emacs style chords like that. You can't do Control R P as separate things. Like, I'm gonna eventually, but right now I just have one keystroke. Like, you can have a modifier and then a keystroke. You can't have two keystroke combos yet. It's starting to look like I'm running out of room, so I'm gonna need to pick a more powerful paradigm to build things with going forward. Up until the point where I actually just go ahead and implement the three paradigms, but it might be the Emacs one I do. Yeah, Control A, select all is a pretty standard thing. Since I don't normally do that in Forcoder for some reason, I don't know. I don't need to do that. Most of the time I select all somewhere else and paste it into Forcoder. Very rarely do I select all in Forcoder because my files are so big. But I agree, select all does make sense on Control A. Normally. Okay, so let's try this out. Whoops. Please go back to 4Coder. There we go. Build that. Still missing that semicolon. Now, this one, the range of the rename is sort of spread out more. So it's possible that the relex won't work and it'll have to go into parallel mode, which means I might need to now go back and make a smarter relex that I was hoping I could punt on for now. But let's see. Alt P, new name, part. See that? Mikkel, did you see it? I'll do it again. You probably want to see it again. So this is, whoops, not Control P. Alt, this would really be better described as a file array. Oh, interesting. Interesting. So there was a bug, but more importantly, there's also a bu two bugs. First of all, it doesn't handle nesting. It always thinks the first brace ends it, which I can fix easily, but it also broke down here again. Huh. All right, one thing at a time. Let's take care of the rename parameter bug first, because that's the easy one. And if that one's fixed, it'll be easier for me to think of reason through what's going wrong with the other one. So, what I didn't account for was nesting level. But that's not hard to fix. Nesting level equals 0. All right, so if I see a brace closed, if the nesting level already equals 0, right? Else, subtract 1 from the nesting level. And if I see a brace open, then add 1 to the nesting level. Okay, so let's try this again. Alt P, file array. Odd. That didn't trigger any bugs in the relax system. I mean, it worked. But why should it work? But not before. Well, not work before. It was like before, it shifted that comment color backwards, which suggests. that it hadn't accounted for all of these replacements, but now it has? Doesn't make any sense. Ah, here's other broken stuff. Good. It's more like it. So this has shifted the switch color backwards. Yeah, the entire file looks like it got relexed with the wrong. That's kind of awesome. All right, so yeah, I guess I should take a look at that. File view. Do bat batch. I'm looking for like token fixing. There we go. Is it just giving me the wrong shift total, or what's the deal here? Because when I replace data with part, nothing goes wrong, right? Whoops, not Control P, Alt P. Alt P, part. Shift total. Ooh, shift total 0. No. That's dumb. Oh wait, no, shift total 0 is not dumb. It's just correct. So let's try this one. If I replace that with file array, the shift total, what do I get? 5. Now here's some questions. Batch size is 7. It's bullshit. Shift total can't be 5. It's got to be a multiple of 7 for starters. Okay. All right, the original length was 5, the new length is 5 longer, so it should be 5 times 7, it should be 35. All right, yeah, you do a bunch of shit, and then you come over here, you buffer batch edit update cursors. Shift amount equals 0 to begin with. At each step you do shit, and then you do some other shit. And then you plus 5. And position, edit, and edit 2 zeros. Count of 3. Excuse me? Cursor count. Oh, the cursor count is 3. So where does end edit come from? Edit count. End edit count is 7. Good. And you're telling me the position, I am already at the position. So, oh, damn. Yep, I see. So I need to finish looping over the edits. 226. Well, actually more like 244. Okay, whatever you just did, don't do that. Don't do that. There you go. So, for the edit less than the end edit, please plus plus the edit, and then shift amount plus equals the edit len. Oh, not plus plus. I want you to plus equals the edit len. Can't even plus plus. That's not a binary operator. It doesn't make any sense. What do you even... I don't even know. All right, put that right there. Actually, let's just do it like this. All right, let's give this a shot. Alt P, file array. Okay, let's just stop. I want to see this without breaking, because I want there to be like a dramatic moment. I was hoping for a dramatic moment, people. I'm sorry. We'll try again. It's going to be this like exciting, dramatic moment now. There you go. There's your exciting, dramatic moment. It worked. And no, Mikkel, I'm not doing local variable names. That's ridiculous. This is good enough. And check this out. The undo undoes all of them at once. All right. So that's been 2 hours of streaming. I'd be happy with that as calling that as today's stream, unless anyone's got any ideas as good as parameter renaming. That was a good one, Mikkel. Your follow-up was not as clever. More ridiculous and difficult. Yeah. But if no one has any ideas, then we can call that the end of the stream today. I think that's enough experimenting. We got an idea of what we can do. Alright, sounds like we're going to call this the end of the stream if Ginger Bill has his way, because he's just saying bye now. Yeah, if Ginger Bill streams, that'd be perfect. Ah, too bad. Alright, well. There you have it. I did a magic trick. We had a dramatic moment. We've done a couple of cool things today. Don't forget, we also made this work. So I think it's an interesting one indeed. This makes me think. I think the auto indenter inserts spaces everywhere, even though it knows that everything is going to be spaces. It doesn't overlap them the way that the parameter renamer does. Let me just demonstrate what I mean. You know how with the parameter namer you can go like, a string's not a particularly descriptive name. It should be something like directory. And it just works like that and is magic. And each of those directories got written out of the same thing and in the history system that is stored as one string. I think the auto indent should be compressed like that. I don't know, I'm going to be revisiting the undo system in 4.0.12, so I'll take a look then at ways we can make that better. But yes, thank you all for coming out to the stream today. I think it's been awesome, and I'll see you guys around next time. Bye-bye.